The bishop must fast only on the days on which all people fast, because if he comes to the church and someone brings something, he must eat with the community. The bishop shall take enough food and drink to sustain himself so that he will not be too lazy to teach those who are unschooled. A bishop must not be extravagant, nor must he be a wanderer or a rover. His living must not be full of pleasures, nor shall he eat choice food. He shall give himself to the teachings with the whole heart. Let him always teach and read the divine books. Let him know well the verses of the holy books in order to be able to explain the books exactly. He shall interpret the gospel, the Pentateuch, and the prophets. The Lord has said, search and see the scriptures, for they give testimony of me. He must not seek profit, which entails shame, by associating with others, especially with infidels. Nor shall he desire to have the greater share. He shall not oppress the people, nor befriend the rich and hate the poor. He must not love one who slanders others, nor shall he testify falsely or be irascible. He shall not stand surety for anyone, nor shall he hunger after the position of the chief, or be double-hearted, or be double-tongued. Nor shall he be one prone to listen to stories. He shall not go to the feast of infidel people, nor shall he love luxury or covet money. For all such things are the enemies of God and companions of the devil. He must be wise and prudent so that he may know evil and avoid it. He shall strive to be beloved by all men. He shall try to be the best of men, because a shepherd, if he stands far from injustice, draws his disciples and encourages them to emulate him in his good work and in truth. In fact, the prophet Hosea said, "How the priest is, thus the people will be." Our good master, Jesus Christ, our God, also first began to do and then to teach, and said, "He that does and teaches shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." After his consecration, the bishop shall be devoted to the service of the altar and shall pray day and night. And if in every hour he prays for himself and for the people, he does good. He shall be alone in the church, and if there is someone with whom he likes to stay, or if there are two or three persons who are as one soul with him, he shall have them with him, so that they may help him in what is necessary. And especially shall he be accompanied by others during prayer, so that he may pray together with others and beseech the Lord in harmony with others. For the Lord has said, "Where there are two or three gathered together in my name, there am I with them." If he cannot stay in the church continuously, he shall say the canonical hours wherever he is. He shall beseech God wholeheartedly and with every effort, so that the word he utters may bear fruit of the Holy Spirit. He must know every word he teaches, and remember that he himself must put each into practice before teaching it, so that he may know exactly what he says. Because if he knows what he says, those who hear him shall know what he says to them. The second part of this section deals with what he must do in respect to his people, and what he must command them. Apostle Paul said to Timothy, "A bishop and his disciple, I pray thee, first of all, that thou beginnest to make request to God with prayer, supplications, and thanksgiving for all men, that they may stay in patience, quiet, silence, and in the fear of God, in purity, because these things lead to God, the life-giver, who wishes all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of his truth. Be thou an example to the faithful in word, in life, of perfection, in charity, in faith, and in chastity. Until I come, attend to reading, to teaching, and to exhortation. Neglect not his grace that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy, and with the imposition of the bishop's hands. Take heed to thyself, and be whole in these things, for in doing this thou shalt save both thyself and them that hear thee. Rebuke not aged men, but entreat and comfort them, and gladden them as fathers, the young men as thy brethren, old women as mothers, young women as thy sister in all chastity and honor. With regards to orphans and widows, do according to justice. Against a priest receive not an accusation unless there is testimony offered by two or three persons. Them that sin reprove before magistrates, that all men may have fear. Do not do anything through favoritism to either side. Hasten not to impose hands upon anyone, neither be a partaker by this of other men's sins." A- Alas for those who have corrupted themselves and have gone astray, and consider that the fear of God is a commerce and gain, let thee be far from them. As for us, we have a great gain, that is, the fear of God, along with enough food. We brought nothing into the world, and we know that we cannot carry anything out from it. Therefore, it is necessary that we take from the world only the food and the clothing that is enough for us. But those who love riches and desire to become rich fall into temptation and into the snare of the devil and into many conspicuousnesses which lead into error and plunge a person into corruption and perdition. For the desire of money is the root of all evil, and many persons have coveted this and have erred from the faith and have brought themselves into many tribulations. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and pursue justice, uprightness, along with the path of the faith, charity, patience, and humility. Fight for the right and good faith, and thou wilt have the eternal life for which thou art called. Command the rich of this world not to be proud, nor to trust in their riches, in which there is no confidence. But they must trust in the living God, who gives us all things in the conspicuousness of his riches for our benefit. Let the faithful be rich in good works, and let them give promptly with equal measure, and lay down for themselves a good foundation for things to come, so that they may hold on to the true life. O Timothy, keep what is entrusted to thee, and avoid hearing vain things and drolleries of the lying world, because those who seek such things have deviated from the faith. Grace be with thee. Amen. Be eager to teach, O Bishop, and if you can explain the words taken from all books, satisfy your people and enlighten them with the light of your laws, so that your people may be rich through the abundance of your teaching. And you, O Bishops, must be vigilant and watch over your people. For you are the eyes of Christ, and God has said through the prophet Ezekiel, with reference to you, Son of Man, I have made thee a watchman of this people, so that thou mayest hear from me the word, and announce it to the people, and watch over the people. Since if thou tellest not the sinner to keep away from sin, and if that sinner dies in his sin, I will require his blood from thy hands. But if thou hast given warning to the sinner from the beginning, and hast spoken to dissuade him from doing evil, and he converts not and dies in his sin, thou hast delivered thy soul. Therefore, teach those who live without knowledge, and comfort those who are learned. Bring to the truth those who have erred, and speak to them always about their error. Maintain yourself, O Bishop, in purity in all your work, and know the degree of your dignity, since because of your dignity you are like God in the eyes of the people, and have become chief over the people and over all the kings, the judges, and the priests, the parents and their children who are learned, and over all those who are subject to your command. Stay in your church, and preach the divine word, since you have the power to judge the sinners. Indeed to you, O Bishop, Christ has said, Whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound also in heaven. Judge with power similar to God's, except whoever repents, because the Lord is a God of mercy. Reproach whoever sins, and drive not away him who does penance. Take care, O bishops, of the salvation of every man. As to you, our Lord has said, see that you despise not any one of these little ones, and know by this that he will want you to account for whatever was entrusted to you. Moreover, you have to know that he who has had much in trust will be asked for much. Be blameless, so that no one will be scandalized because of you. A layman cares for himself, but you have carried a great burden. It is written that God said to Moses, thou and Aaron shall bear the sins of the heedless people. Teach those who are heedless, and know that you will have a great reward if you do it, as well as a great punishment if you neglect it. If one who has a great sin comes to you, neglect him not. In connection with the bishop who neglects his people, the prophet Ezekiel has said, woe to the shepherds of Israel who left their sheep to feed alone. Are you not the shepherds who feed the flocks? You drink the milk, and you clothe yourselves with wool, and kill that which was fat. But you look not after my flock. You strengthen not the weak. You heal not the broken. You seek not the strayed. You recover not the lost. You teach them not with love, but with derision. And my sheep are scattered because there was no shepherd. And they became the food of the lions of the desert. He also said, I will judge between sheep and shepherd, and between sheep and male goats. And he who has sinned, whom you, O bishop, have driven away with excommunication, do not leave him out, but bring him back to the church. Seek him who is astray, and him who hopes for no salvation because of the great number of his sins. You shall not leave him to be lost completely. Thus also the bishop must himself bear the sin of the sinner, and must do as if he had sinned more, and say to him who has sinned, Be converted, and I will accept death by thy stead, as did our Lord who died for me and for all men, and said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. But the hireling, who is not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, him he sees the wolf, who is the devil coming. He leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches those sheep. O watcher of the sheep, seek the sheep that is gone astray, since our Lord has said, He leaves the 99 and in the mountain and goes to seek that which was gone astray. And when he finds it, he lays it, upholds his shoulders, and drives it into the sheepfold, rejoicing for it. If one is sick with sins, he looks for an intelligent physician who can help him in his sickness. And our Lord has said, They that are in health need not a physician, but they that are ill. And the Son of Man, when he came, because he himself was a physician, he saved and healed the sick. Do not love the slanderous and the greedy. And if you see a sinner, reproach him little by little. Do not hasten to drive him away, but order the deacons to meet him out of the church, to persuade him, to bring him in, and to pray for him. Then fix for him a fasting period for his sin, in proportion to his strength, be it 1 week or 2 weeks, or 3 or 4, or 5 or 6 days. Teach him so that he may reform, as he must, for his sin to be forgiven, and respect him, and teach him so that he may be humble and meek in himself. And you, O bishops, must look at our Savior, and our King, and our God, Jesus Christus, as your model. Be his ministers, and imitate him, so that you may be merciful, peacemakers, not envious, nor proud, nor hypocrites, nor boastful, nor immoderate eaters and drinkers. Do not despise the gift of God, but you shall receive it because you were administrators of God, and to him you will render an account of an administration and of the observance of the law he gave to you. A bishop shall take the food and clothing he needs in purity, for a reward is forthcoming to him who serves. He shall never adorn his clothing, but shall take what is necessary to cover his body without extra fine ornaments. You are now priests of your people. You are Levites, ministers of the holy tabernacle, which is the holy church. You are the fathers of the people under your power. You are the chief over magistrates, kings, and administrators. You are the peacemakers between God and men. You are his faithful servants, forgivers of each person's sins. And it is you who answers for everything. You will also receive a great reward from God and the honor of his unutterable glory. You render a good service to the Holy Church. As you bore the sin of everyone, so will take food, clothing, and whatever you need from everyone. Be skillful, just like the silversmith, who after testing metals keeps the best. A bishop must do in like manner with the men he keeps close to him. Let him not heal those who are false and sinners. If their sickness has no remedy, he shall drive them far away from him. But he shall not do so irreparably as by excommunication. Never shall he entrust to another, whomsoever he be, the spiritual or the government of his people. But he himself must rule his people as he should. He shall not believe any false witness against them. As a man of God, you shall be patient and not hasty to accept the word of one who accuses his brethren falsely through envy or wickedness, since such people by their accusation destroy the continuous reign of peace. Observe them keenly and be weary of them, so that you will not lose those who are not sinners. If you find that their accusation is true, you shall deal with it according to the teachings of the Lord. Take the accused alone and reproach him, if he does not wish to repent after thy reproach. Take with thee one witness or two, and teach him gently the spiritual doctrine. If he accepts thy counsel, it will be good for him. But if he does not mend his ways, thou shalt tell the counsel so that it will rebuke him. And if he obeys not the counsel, thou shalt tell the church. And if he hears not the church, thou shalt take him for a heathen and publican. He shall not communicate with you until he does penance. If he repents as the publican did, and mends his ways, he shall be allowed to enter the church to hear the words of God, until the fruit of penance becomes visible in him. Do not, O bishop, allow them to participate in all the prayers. Rather, after the reading of the gospel, bid them to leave, so that they may regret their past, whilst the rest of the congregation devotes themselves to the Christian calling. Whosoever sees them shall feel sorry for them, and shall be careful not to fall into prevarication, and shall be afraid lest what befall them. If a sinner falls once or twice, do not abandon him, nor prevent him from associating with the faithful. He may also take meals with them, accept his penance, and dress him in clothes similar to those of the repentant son, who returned to his father. Lay your hands on them, instead of baptizing them, because by the imposition of our hands, penitents receive the grace of the Holy Spirit. Restore them to their former place. In the same manner, heal the sinners and supply them with good and soft medicine, and fortify them with words of admonition. Dress their wounds, and if the wounds are profound and full of pus, they should be healed with strong medicine, which is the word of admonition, and then with words of comfort. If the wounds spread and cuts off the limbs of the body, and nothing to cure it is found, a wise physician should be sought, with great care, attention, and counsel. He may, in spite of the pain and sorrow, cut off the limb so that the other limbs will not be similarly affected, since the sacred book says, "Take away the evil out of the midst of you. Do not hasten to cut, nor be daring and hasty to saw off with a sharp toothed saw." And if the accuser is false, do not listen to him. For know that if you pass judgment against someone unjustly, a judgment of vengeance will leave your mouth against yourself. But if you judge impartially, you will know who accuses his neighbor falsely. When you discover his lie, punish him publicly, and do not do to him what he wanted to be done to his companion. And make him known in the midst of the community as the killer of his brother. If he repents, order him to fast, and then you shall impose your hand upon him, and receive him. After he promises to neither return to nor persist in his error, neither once more nor twice. If he abandons not his malice, he shall be expelled, because he is an evildoer, so that he will not contaminate the church of God. Pass not the same judgment on all sins. Your judgment on one who sins by deed must not be like that of one who sins by words or by thoughts. There are some who deserve reproach only, and there are others who are commanded to give alms to the poor. Others are commanded to fast, and still others are expelled from the church in proportion to the gravity of the sin they have committed. The law does not prescribe the same punishment for all sinners, for the punishment of one who sins against God, against the priest, and against the sanctuary is not like the punishment of one who sins with injustice against the king or against one of his companions. Nor is it like the punishment of one who injures his own companion and servants, nor like that of one who sins against his parents and his relatives. Nor is one who sins voluntarily the same as one who sins involuntarily. For to some the punishment of death is due, and to others flogging only. Some deserve fines, and still others the punishment they desired their neighbor to get. Know the difference punishments due to the sinner, so that injustice may not be among you. For as you punish and judge, so also a judgment will be passed on you. If a bishop must pray that peace be upon another, the more reason is that peace be upon him. Otherwise, how could the people live in peace if the prayer for peace is not in him? And this is the will of Christ, that those who are saved be many, and that from the number of the church no soul be lost. And our Lord has said, "He that is not united with me scatters those who are with me." If you are separated from the sheep, you are their enemy and God's adversary and a scatterer of the sheep whose shepherd is God. How is it that you scatter those whom we gathered from many people and many languages with toil, tribulations, vigilance, fasting, by lying on the ground with exiled, chains, and with long suffering, until we fulfilled the will of God, and we filled his house with the chosen people who are the church, the holy community. Stretch, O bishop, your right hand, and as an administrator of God, care to provide for the needs of widows, orphans, and those who have no shelter, the indigent, and all the poor faithful, in such a way that they can feed their children and be able to overcome the sickness which befalls them. Call the orphans who follow you. Take care to feed them, and do not let them fall into poverty. Take care of the young virgin girl until she reaches the age of marriage, and have her married to a faithful. And so with respect to boys, train them in some trade. Teach and feed them so that they can have something to live on, until they can support themselves with the work of their hands. The bishop must correct the layman so that they shall not utter curses. Care must be taken of all, be they clergymen or laymen. The bishop who dresses in silk and fine clothing and adorns his table with varied and tasty food, whilst the poor of this city go hungry and naked, is not a bishop. Third, the people must obey the bishop and do what he commands them. The bishop is next to God, your Father, who begot you a second time by water and Holy Spirit. He who is your God on earth after the Lord, the true God. The Lord has said through the prophet David, I have said, you are gods, and all of you are sons of the Most High. He also said, thou shalt not speak ill of the gods, by which was meant the bishop. O man, it is thanks to bishop that God called you his son. Know in this how he has honored you, and honor him who was for you the cause of his high honor. Do not the holy books say in connection with those who begot you in body, honor thy father and thy mother so that thou mayest have long life, and he that says an evil word to his father and his mother shall die the death. Must you then not honor much more your spiritual fathers? They indeed are the mediators between you and God. They have begot you again by water and the Holy Spirit, and have fed you the milk, which is the word of learning. They have strengthened you by their canons and have rendered you worthy to receive the body of the Savior and the venerated blood that is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christus. They purified you from all your sins and made you worthy of his saintly grace and a partaker of his inheritance. Fear them, for they are given by God the power of life and death, in order that they might judge whoever sins and deliver him against him condemnation to the eternal fire. If he does penance, they shall forgive the sin and shall save him. Therefore must love the bishop as a father, fear him as a king, and respect him as the Lord. You must give what is due to him, and he must administer what is entrusted to him, because he is the judge chosen by God to set in order the things of the church. You shall never ask him to account for his administration. The final part of this word is found in the chapter on alms. The gift to be given to the bishop shall be imposed on each city under his jurisdiction according to the prosperity of the city. The gift shall be brought to him every year by the priest, who will go round to the people of the cities and to the monasteries to collect it, and to bring it to the bishop, so that he will be helped in his necessity. If the shepherd falls into evil, death is clearly before him. If there is a bishop who, because of lack of wisdom, loves vengeance, he is not a bishop, but bears the false title of bishop. He is not from God, but from men. Fourth, on the bishop's relationship with the priest and archpriest, and with priest in particular, Apostle Paul said to Titus, his disciple and bishop, know that I left thee to set in order the things that are wanting, and to ordain as priests those who are blameless. The rest of this passage is found in the chapter on priests, and in the chapter on the Mass. It is said that the bishop shall take his place before the altar, and his name must be mentioned in every prayer. The bishop shall not be haughty towards the priests and deacons. nor the priest towards the people. The bishop shall bless the priest, and never shall the latter bless him. He shall confer ordinations and receive the illogy by the hand of bishops, and not by the hand of the priest. He shall depose any priest who deserves to be deposed, but not a bishop, as he cannot do this alone. He must record and know all the ranks of the priest and their position, lest disputes arise between them regarding it, and lest the men of the apostolic church be equal in rank with laymen, or lest the priest be equal in rank with the archpriest. Be, O bishops, of a single heart among yourselves, and commiserate with the sorrowful. Save the brethren, and feed the people with harmony and purity of heart for their redemption. Teach them to be one will of the spirit and of the body, so that they may be one in thought and in counsel, in accordance with the commandment of our Father. A bishop must not leave his see and his city and go to another city, unless it is to reconcile other bishops like him, who are of those to the people of that country, by promulgating laws for the remission of their sins. In this case, he shall stay there until the need they have of him is over. No bishop shall receive a man excommunicated by another bishop, regardless of whether the excommunicated man was a priest, a monk, or a layman. Neither shall he loosen the excommunicated, nor say any prayer of absolution, lest it be a sign of contempt for the bishop who excommunicated him. If the bishop who excommunicated him is wicked and oppressive, and his wickedness is known among the bishops, a report shall be made to his superior, the metropolitan, and the other bishops like him, so that they may write to him about his conduct and speak to him. If he persists, he shall be removed from his office. A bishop shall not go to any place other than that to which he is appointed, either because his country is great or small in size, or because there is a scarcity of inhabitants or gifts. He shall not seek a better see than it. He is not allowed to do such a thing, since every man is given his share by God. This act is comparable to that of laymen who marry women. If, in fact, a man is on bad terms with his wife, for reasons other than adultery, and desires to replace her with another woman better than she, he sins gravely. Similarly, bishops and priests who seek what is better than their country sin gravely. We excommunicate and depose such men, for such a habit is a bad one. And if there is any ground that justifies leaving the city, so much so that there is no alternative being transferred from it, he may leave it and must be sent to another city. If it is recognized that his purity, his good administration, and his faith were not affected by this, if he is worthy, he shall be transferred to a higher see, because he did not leave his first see of his own will. A bishop comes to the see of another bishop in search of honor and praise, and stays there for a long time because he finds it advantageous to be away from his see. And if he knows that the bishop of that see has little learning, he must not despise or scoff at this bishop, nor shall he bless the priest who want the full blessing, for only the bishop of the see is entitled to bless them. Lest the people desire him, he must not ordain priest and be absent from his church, nor must he be absent himself for more than 3 weeks to attend to his own affairs. And if he stays for a long time at the place he went to for some purpose, he shall not be accompanied by more than 3 persons, nor testimony of heretics shall be accepted against a bishop. The testimony of only 1 bishop against him shall not be accepted. Fifth, on the bishop's synod, which must take place twice a year. This part is in 2 sections. First, the synod of bishops shall take place twice a year, and shall deal with matters pertaining to the church and with matters of interpretation or arrangement which are difficult for some. The bishop shall put an end to the scandals found in the church. If there are enmities, they shall settle them peacefully. The first synod shall be called on the 4th week of the 5th 50 days between Easter and Pentecost. The second synod shall be called on the 12th of Tempchet. Second, the bishop of every place shall meet their metropolitan or their patriarch twice a year. The first meeting shall take place before Lent, to remove evil and anger, and to make their sacrifice during the Holy Lenten, time pure and acceptable to God. The second shall be held in autumn, after the Feast of the Cross, because epidemics and sudden death are more frequent in summer and in autumn. Thus it is held to assure love and peace before death, and that they may go to our Lord Jesus Christus clean and pure. They shall meet to examine sentences passed on priests and on others whom the bishops have excommunicated, lest there be spite of anything like it. And they shall judge according to what they deem proper. And if it is known that some of the priests have offended a bishop, he shall be punished severely, and shall be prevented from entering the church and from associating with the faithful. If he obeys the bishop by accepting the punishment, he shall not be reproached by the synod for his sin, for he has confessed to obtain pardon for the hate, the anger, and the evil he has committed against the bishop. He shall restore him to his former position. If the bishop bears malice and is angry and violent against him, let the bishop be deposed. If any bishop is called to this synod, he shall not fail to come, and must not absent himself unless he has a known and justifying cause, in which case he shall write a letter explaining the cause and shall be given permission, as they are gathered with the patriarch to ask all the questions they may have. He shall give his decisions. They shall keep the proceedings secret unless they deem it necessary to reveal them to someone who has great knowledge and faith. No one except the learned men shall ever stay near the bishops during the synod. At the center of the assembly room, a chair shall be placed. The Holy Gospel shall be placed upon it. The patriarch shall sit facing the bishops on the doors, and the doors shall be closed. They shall stand up together and pray, and then shall sit down and examine secretly the matter that was the cause of their gathering. And when they arrive at a sentence mitigated by mercy and pass it against the person who deserves it, as God wishes it, they shall make it public. Sixth, the episcopal office shall not be transmitted by succession. The law of the church does not authorize this, because the office is a divine thing. It shall not be bequeathed either to relatives or to non-relatives. The same holds true for the priesthood. Seventh, two bishops shall not be appointed over one city. If the inhabitants of a city or a village disagree with their bishop so that they are divided into two parts, and as a result another bishop is appointed, an inquiry shall be made into it, and if nothing which warrants disposition is found against the first bishop, he shall occupy his place. But if something is found against him, he shall be excommunicated and shall be replaced by another against whom there is no blame. Two bishops may not be permitted to stay both in a city. It is only the abrotros, that is, the comos, who act on behalf of the bishop, who may stay there. If the bishop is in the city, the comos shall not do anything without consulting the bishop of the village. Eighth, this part deals with causes which, if proved against the bishop, even if it is only one that is proved, bring about the removal of the bishop from his office. In this chapter, they are 25. The first, second, third, and fourth pertain to one who takes the episcopal office with bribery, violence, or fraud, and one who confers that rank after taking a bribe. The bishop, priest, or deacon who receives holy orders with bribery shall be deposed, as shall he be who ordained him. And no one shall associate with either, as I, Peter, did with Simon the magician. If one avails himself of assistance given by secular princes and is placed over the church by them, he shall be deposed and expelled together with those who were his companions. Or whosoever promises to give bribes and is consequently anointed by fraud shall be his appointment rejected. If he obtains it fraudulently, he shall be deposed and shall be considered as a heathen by you. He shall be driven away from the church of God, and one shall avoid speaking to him or associating with him, as I, Peter, avoided any association with Simon, the magician, and expelled him from the Church of God by the command of the Holy Spirit. And if any bishop receives goods from a person he ordains, and the latter is not worthy, he shall be excommunicated. The magician Simon mentioned by the apostles in their canons is the one who was mentioned by Luke in the book of the Acts of the Apostles when he said, "When Simon saw that the Holy Spirit was given by the imposition of the apostles' hand, he offered them money, saying, 'Give me also the power that when I lay my hand on someone, he may receive the Holy Spirit.' But Simon, later known as Peter, said to him, 'Let thy money go to perdition with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with worldly money. Thou hast not part nor lot in this faith, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God.'" But do come back from this thy wickedness, and pray to God that he may forgive thee the wickedness of thy heart. Fifth, if in matters concerning his administration any bishop places himself under the protection of outsiders or secular princes to get help from them in ruling the church and tries to debase God's people under his jurisdiction, or to be unduly haughty towards them, or to appropriate another bishop's church, he shall be excommunicated and deposed, together with all those who helped him in this deed. Sixth, if a bishop accepts presents from priests and deacons and refrains from ousting them from their office in spite of a judgment against them, he shall be deposed. Seventh cause, if a patriarch, a metropolitan, or a bishop, since this holds good in all three cases, resigns from his office after his appointment and acceptance, even for a single day or hour of the appointment, and then flees from his see, he shall be reproached by the people of his community until he assents and returns to his see. Otherwise, he shall be driven away from the place where he desired to remain and prevented from associating with the community. If he does not return after the request of the people of his country, they may choose. If they wish, they may let him stay with them, and may mention his name in their prayers. But if they are against him, they shall not mention his name, because they must pray for him only if he has prayed for them. 8 and 9. If a bishop or priest or deacon has ordained twice, he shall be deposed together with the one who ordained him, unless he proves that he was ordained the first time by heretics. Similarly, if he had married twice before the ordination and was ordained later, he shall be deposed together with one who ordained him. But if the one who ordained him did not conceive with him, only the ordained shall be deposed. 10th, if there is a bishop who likes taking revenge and is prone to anger, so much that he binds and excommunicates very often, never refrains from this conduct, is always hungry for honor, and never quits his spite in issuing excommunications, he shall be deposed. Similarly, all those who are like him shall be excommunicated. A bishop, whose duty is to judge, delivers an unjust judgment against anyone, the judgment he delivers shall turn against him. A bishop must be a leader who admonishes the people and binds them with the cross, and not with excommunication. Never shall he bind or excommunicate unjustly. If he binds or excommunicates unjustly with the desire to sadden the people, or to mislead them, or to make them entreat him, he shall be bound and excommunicated by God, and his priests shall justly enough rise against him. If they cannot settle the matter in any other way, they shall inform the metropolitan or the patriarch, who shall justly enough rise against him, and shall not allow him to offend again Christ's sheep, which he brought with his blood, or to exasperate and induce them to blaspheme God and deny his saintly law. Neither shall he be allowed to judge, nor shall he command as one invested with authority. And once deposed, he shall be steadfast in his faith, admitting fairly his fault, and doing penance for it as he ought to. He shall ask for forgiveness from God for his injustice. The judges shall not leave him to return to his wrong ways, and the people shall consider his punishment as something to his benefit, as something he deserved, and he shall entreat God for forgiveness for his fault. 11th cause. The bishop or the priest or the deacon who neglects to teach his priest and his people, and neglects the service and fear of God, shall be put apart. If he persists in his negligence, he shall be deposed. And so our Lord did and taught from the beginning. Luke has said, all the apostles were perseverant to teach the entire day in the sanctuary and the temple. So also Paul commands his disciples to be perseverant in teaching. 12th cause. If there is a bishop or priest who takes no care of the priest and poor and does not give to them what he can afford to give, he shall be set apart. If he persists in his indifference, he shall be deposed, as he is a killer of his brother. 13th cause. The bishop or the priest who receives not the sinner who has repented shall be deposed, for he has transgressed what our Lord Jesus Christus has said. There shall be great joy in heaven over the sinner who does penance. And our Lord came not to call the just, but the sinners to penance. 14th cause. If any bishop or priest or deacon is a habitual drunkard, an evildoer, or one who does not good deeds, or seeks usury from one who pays debt, or if he is a false witness or a backbiter, or is haughty towards others and acts as if he were greater than they and watches after the people of God with indifference, he will not have a good name in his life, nor mercy from God after death. No one shall be a chief of Christians, and no one shall be entrusted with the government of the church, but the one who knows it, its laws and its canons, and observes them. If he transgresses them, he shall be deposed by force from his office. The one who lies down with a heathen woman or with a fornicatress shall be driven away and deposed from his office. No clergyman shall cohabit with such women, lest he diminish the faith of the faithful and the priest. He shall also avoid cohabitation with women, friends for whose sons he acted as godfather. For the devil is an enemy who fights against Christians, and especially against their chiefs, who are teachers and close to God. He tries to drive them far from him and from their sacred degree. 15th cause. If a bishop ordains a priest outside the jurisdiction of his see without the consent of the holder of the see, he shall be deposed. If a person comes to a city other than his own or passes through it with the intention to be ordained as a priest or a deacon there, the bishop of that city may not ordain him unless he is accompanied by his own bishop, or unless the metropolitan and the bishops of his country have given him credentials. If a bishop ordains foreigners of his own will, the holy orders of those whom he has ordained shall be annulled, and he shall be deposed. 16th cause. If a bishop expels a priest, and another bishop accepts him with the knowledge of his expulsion, the accepting bishop shall be deposed. If the priests expel a bishop on whom there was no blame and replace him with another, this latter shall be deposed from the episcopal office he holds. No bishop may loosen or bind one who was properly excommunicated by another bishop who is still living. But if the bishop has died, his successor may loosen the one who was excommunicated. The patriarch has the power to loosen and to bind both, because he is like the master of the house. 17th cause. If a bishop is given to secular affairs, he shall be deposed. A bishop may not withdraw himself from the service of Christ and be appointed to any office other office of the king. If he fervently desires such a thing, he shall be deposed, since our Lord has said, no servant can serve two masters, for he will either irritate the one or please the other. 18th cause. If any bishop or minister of the church goes to the king without the verbal or written order of his superior, he shall be shorn of his rank, prevented from association with the faithful, and deprived of the honor he used to have. 19th cause. Every bishop or priest or deacon who is in order to be feared by the people strikes a member of the faithful or an infidel when he commits a sin, shall be deposed. 20th cause. A bishop shall be removed from his office if he believes in the calculus of the stars, as will be he who believes the talk of diviners and sorcerers and accepts their word. 21st cause. If a bishop or priest or deacon was baptized by heretics or has received their Eucharist, he shall be deposed, and if he has prayed with them, he shall be set apart. 22nd cause. If one is appointed bishop in his country, but is not accepted by the inhabitants of the country, or by the greater part of their assembly, or if there is a dispute on his account, or if they want to go to another see because of their opposition to the one who is appointed to their see, a distinction must be made. If the opposed bishop humbles himself and wishes to remain a priest as he was before being appointed bishop, let it be so, and the episcopal rank he held shall be recognized, and he shall have seniority, but only in the assembly. If he provokes dissension against the bishop who was appointed in that place as his replacement, and against the one who consecrated the latter, he shall be deposed from his sacerdotal dignity as well. But if he is solicitous of the welfare of the diocese, he shall become bishop again after he behaves well, and shall be taken out of the sacerdotal degree. 23rd cause. If a bishop is accused by reliable faithful, and other bishops shall call him, and when he comes, if he confesses his sin, they shall admonish him for what he did, and shall punish him. If he refuses to come, they shall send to him an envoy representing the bishops, either once or twice. And if he refuses, they shall send him an envoy for the third time. If he does not come, the council of the bishops shall order his deposition, lest he believe that his refusal to come to the council of the bishops was to his advantage. 24th cause. If a bishop goes on a journey and leaves his see, he shall not absent himself for more than 6 months. If he exceeds this period unnecessarily and without permission of the patriarch, and celebrates the feast of Easter in a see other than his own, he shall be suspended from his priestly rank. 25th cause. If a bishop receives, like any other priest, a priest who left his own church, and if he does not send him back at the request of his bishop, he shall be expelled. Whosoever gives money to be appointed bishop shall have his appointment annulled, and he who consecrated him must be punished. All these provisions on bishops are in addition to whatever is found in the chapter on priest and other chapters. Chapter 6, Priest. The chapter is divided into 6 parts: the requirements necessary for appointment, ordination, the ranks, the precepts, causes of disposition, and matters which are not causes for disposition. 1. The requirements. Apostle Paul said to his disciple Titus, "Know that I left thee so that thou mightest put in order the things that were wanting, and that thou mightest ordain priests in every city, as I had commanded thee." The person to be ordained must be one who is without blame, the husband of one wife, with faithful children, who are not accused of luxury, who are not obstinate, and who are obedient. For it is proper that a priest, as the steward of God, be blameless. He must not be one who behaves by following his own counsel only, nor one who nurses a grudge, who is given to much wine, who is ready to strike others, or who is greedy for filthy profits. Rather, he should be given to hospitality and to good deeds, chastity, good, just and good, one who restrains himself from conspicuousnesses, who helps teach the word of faith, who can console others by teaching justice, and who rebukes gainsayers and deceivers. A priest shall be ordained at the age of 30. Even if he is worthy before that age, he shall wait until he reaches it, because our Lord was baptized at that age of 30, and then he began to teach. One who cannot interpret the words of the divine books accepted as good, especially the 4 Gospels, shall not be ordained, and no one shall be priest unless 5 persons testify to his worthiness. 2. The ordination. When a bishop wants to ordain a priest, he shall impose his hands on his head. All the priests as well shall stand up, touch him, and pray over him in the matter already prescribed in the chapter on bishops. and no one shall be ordained priest or deacon without the approval of the bishop who has jurisdiction over him. And only one bishop shall ordain a priest, for the bishop's rank comes third. 3. The rank. A priest is like a teacher. Priests shall be considered by you as teachers of the knowledge of God, and you shall receive from them the word of the true faith and the true doctrine that we taught. Our Lord has commanded us when he wanted to send us to preach the gospel by saying, "Go and teach ye all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you." A priest has only one power, and that is to teach, to baptize, to say mass, and to give benediction to the people. He shall be with the bishop when the latter sits to judge. He shall give benediction, but he shall not receive benediction from one who is inferior to him in rank. He shall receive the eulogy from the bishop, and from a priest on an equal footing with him. He shall impose his hands on the head of the people, but he shall not ordain anyone, nor shall he depose anyone. He shall not expel one who has committed a fault. The word which is in the book of the canons of the apostles says, "And he shall accuse the one who has a fault, if the latter is one who deserves punishment." The precepts pertinent to him. Peter has said in his first letter, "And the priests that are among you, I, a priest, their companion, beseech them by saying, feed the flock of God, which is among you, provide them with the Spirit of God, not by constraint, but willingly, not with bad spirit, but with peaceful heart, not like masters who terrify, but as a shepherd to a flock, so that when the Prince of Shepherds shall appear, you may receive a never-fading crown of glory. Priests shall be like the seniors, who did not take even one wife, so that they may participate in the mysteries with the bishop and help him in everything and gather with love around their pastor." The interpreter has said, "I think that the seniors mentioned above are the 24 priests who were spiritual ministers. The priests who stand at the right must be sure to help in the sanctuary to honor the one who deserves honor and to debase the one who deserves to be debased. But the priest who stands to the left shall take care of the people gathered in the church and make sure that they are quiet, do not cause disturbances, behave well in every respect, and are fully obedient. Priests must not walk ahead of the bishop around the altar, nor shall they enter the sanctuary before him, nor seat themselves around the bishop's chair, until the bishop seats himself in their midst. They shall enter after the bishop. They shall not sit around him unless they are ill or tired because of a journey, and the command to sit down is given them by the bishop. A priest shall not go to the nuptial banquet of one who married two sisters, as the one who stays with two sisters must do penance. How then is it possible that a priest eat with him at such a banquet? No priest shall add a burden of any sort on the people beyond that imposed by the canons of our fathers, the apostles. Now therefore, why do ye tempt God and put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we are able to bear? For this reason I say that you must not add any trouble to those who are converted to God. Now it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to lay no further burden upon you beyond these things, which you shall not do. No priest shall undress himself before another man, except in case of necessity. If he needs and wishes to go to public baths, he shall go only with others of rank equal to his, and before the coming of the layman to the bath. The priest shall gather around their bishops 3 times a year, and shall examine everything they need. 4. The part which deals with the causes that bring about a priest's disposition. Mention has already been made in the chapter on bishops of some of these causes, and the fact that they were promulgated in writings specifying their number. The following are the causes Any priest who attains the rank of priest with bribery, by intimidation, or favoritism, by deceit, or by promising bribes, shall be deposed. Also one who has been ordained twice, or one who has married two wives, or one who neglects the education of his people, or one who does not take care of the poor priest, nor helps him, shall be deposed. The following also shall be deposed. One who does not accept the repentance of sinners. One who is known to have given false testimony, or to have backbitten people. One who is haughty. One who knows the law, but does not observe it. One who is given to drunkenness and to evil doing. One who habitually neglects to do good. One who lends with interest. One who lives with a fornicatress, even if she is his goddaughter, or does anything similar. One who goes to the king without the permission of his superior. One who strikes someone to terrify the people. One who believes in the calculus of the stars. One who believes in the sayings of diviners and sorcerers. One who baptized by heretics, or one who takes their Eucharist or prays with them. Other causes are found in the chapter on the clergy, and this is its summary. The following persons shall be expelled or deposed: one who makes himself an eunuch, one who is found committing fornication, theft, or swearing falsely, one who believes that marriage or eating meat or drinking wine is a prohibited thing, one who eats in the markets and drinks in banquets, one who eats animals which are found dead, or animals that were half eaten by wild animals, one who enters the temple of Jews, or who enters the churches of heretics to be cured, one who fasts with the Jews and celebrates the feast of the Passover with them, or receives gifts offered during their feast, one who sends gifts to their temple, or to the sacred places of infidels, or to churches of heretics, one who brings gifts to or speaks and prays with an excommunicated person, or with one who is cut off from the community of the faithful, or one who goes on a journey without a written permission of his bishop. Chapter 7, Deacons. This chapter is divided into five parts. Part 1, the requirements necessary to appointment. The Apostle Paul, after laying down the precepts that govern priests, said, "Similarly, deacons shall be calm and obedient, not double-tongued, nor given to much wine, nor covetous of filthy liquor. And they shall hold the mystery of faith with pure conscience and great cheerfulness. The rule concerning them is that, first, they must be proved, and then, if they are found blameless, let them serve as deacons. Let a deacon be the husband of one wife, one who rules his own house and his children well, for they that have ministered well shall purchase themselves a good degree and much grace in the faith which is in our Lord Jesus Christus." Matthew has said, "Deacons shall be appointed on the testimony of two or three persons, since it is written that on the testimony of two or three everything shall be settled, and they shall be tested in every service. The community shall testify that they have lived with only one wife, and have brought up their children in purity. They shall be merciful and mild. They shall not grumble, nor shall they be double-tongued, nor prone to be angry. For anger ruins a wise man. Nor shall they be partial to the rich, nor oppress the poor, nor drink much wine. Rather, they shall toil for the good mysteries. They shall command the brethren who possess wealth to give to the poor, and to establish brotherhood with the poor by giving. And deacons shall honor the community with every honor, with respect, and with fear of God." Part 2. Ordination of Deacons. When you are ordained a deacon, you shall impose your hand on him and pray, while all the priests and deacons stand upright. A deacon shall be chosen, as we said before, and only the bishop shall impose his hands on him, because a deacon is ordained not to receive the spirit of greatness in which all priests share, but to carry out the orders of the bishop. Katag 11 Gloss, found in the Roman version, and says, One shall not be ordained deacon before he attains 25 years of age, and this is the rule laid down in the new law. Similarly, the rule of the Levites in the old law prescribed that a Levite should not serve at the tabernacle if he did not attain this age. Moreover, a person cannot have sufficient knowledge of this service if he has not attained this age. But the new law, as regards the service of the diaconate, does not require this. Deacons must be 7 in number, even if the city is small. If the city is large, their numbers shall be fixed freely by the bishop of the city. This rule is found in the book of the Acts of the Apostles. 7 deacons shall be appointed and supported by the church, subject to what the church can afford. The others shall be obedient. And a deacon shall be selected from among 3 candidates. Part 3. Provisions regarding deacons. Deacons shall be blameless, just like the bishop, and shall be greatly honored and perfect in all their services to the church, so that they may act without shame. The deacon who serves the bishop shall be pure in all his work, without any reproach, as if he were serving Christ. Nor shall he do anything by his own will, without the consent of his father, who is the bishop, and who commands him in everything. Priest and the deacons shall be with you. O bishops, when you sit down to render judgment, a deacon shall serve the bishop and priest in everything, like one who serves God, and not only at the time of Mass. He shall also serve, instead of the bishop, those people who are sick and have no one to nurse them. He shall inform the bishop so that the latter can pray for them and send them what they need. The deacon shall also take care of the people who are secretly needy and shall serve those whom alms are given from the sanctuary and by important persons. It is proper that they give alms to widows, orphans, and the poor. In this way, every deacon shall fulfill his duty and thereby become the true deacon of whom Christ said, "He who has served me shall be honored by my Father." A deacon or priest shall read the gospel and watch over the people, lest someone doze, sleep, laugh, or make fun of his companions. He shall seat the people in the manner laid down in the chapter on Mass. A deacon shall not hold the chalice if there are not enough priests. He shall give the holy mysteries to the people when he is allowed to. In the absence of a bishop or priest, he shall give the people the eulogies with his hands at the time of agape. A deacon has no authority to teach, to baptize, to celebrate Mass, or to bless the people. Rather, he shall be devoted to serving the bishop or the priest and shall perform the duties incumbent upon the diaconate. He shall not give the eulogy to a bishop or a priest, but he shall receive it from the bishop or the priest. Neither shall he hold the Eucharist, and when the bishop or the priest holds it, he shall give the chalice to the people. He is not a priest, but one who serves priest. He shall not impose his hands or give the Eucharist to one who is senior to him in rank, but he shall command his juniors in the service of the church. Deacons shall not be seated in front of priests or beside them, be it inside or outside the altar, unless the latter allows them to be so. The archdeacon shall stay behind the bishop or at his side during the prayer, as is proper to a junior. He proclaims every prayer and everything regarding the church. He shall settle disputes or quarrels which may arise among the deacons who are under his authority, and shall not report anything of this to the bishop, as the deacons are under his command. He is the absolute leader in prayer, and every matter concerning the church must be in his hands, lest he lose the honor for coming to him. No person other than the bishop is senior to the archdeacon, as the latter is the superior of the priests. The coruscapus shall be in rank like the two hands and the two wings of the bishop. When the bishop goes to church or elsewhere, the archdeacon shall stay at his right and others at his left, and the bishop shall stay at the center like a father in the middle of his children. The bishop shall not give any orders concerning priests without consulting the archdeacon, for the latter is the guardian of the city, who knows the people. He is the leader in prayer, and must be like the bishop in everything. Part 4. On Obedience. A deacon shall settle the matters which he has the power to settle, and shall consult the bishop on important affairs, so that the latter may decide as he sees fit. An archdeacon is like the bishop's ears, eyes, and mouth. He shall be with the bishop with all his heart, so that the bishop may occupy himself only with important affairs, just as Jethro, the father-in-law of Moses, advised him how to administer justice among the children of Israel, advice which Moses accepted, and by which he settled all matters happily. Gloss. In one of the books of Rome it is said, deacons shall not put on their belt during prayers, for they are free, and have no master other than the Lord Jesus Christos, who is universal King and universal God, and the honor of deacons is manifested by this. Failure to observe the provisions of this chapter does not entail excommunication. You, O deacons, must watch over the needy and speak to your bishops about the needs of the needy. Since you must act as the bishop's soul and body in everything, you must obey him and carry out his orders as you would carry out the orders of a father, a chief, or a teacher. If a deacon gives money to someone because this person is needy, but keeps it secret from the bishop, and if he is charged later before the bishop with negligence towards the needy, and the people and grumble not only against him but also against God, God will judge the deacons and the people as he judgeth Aaron and his sister when he spoke against Moses by saying, "How dare you accuse Moses, my servant?" All deacons shall do good deeds night and day in every place. The one who serves well without sin shall gain and take a good portion in the life to come. Part 5. Causes for deposing a deacon from his rank. One of the causes found in the chapter on bishops and priests applies to all. A deacon shall be deposed if he attained this rank by bribery, force, fraud, or promises to give bribes. If he has been ordained twice or has married two wives, if he is given to drunkenness and does evil things, if he neglects to do good often, if he is one who lends money with interest, if he is one who gives false testimony, if he is a backbiter, if he is haughty, if he cohabits with fornicatress, or goes to the king without the permission of his superior, if he strikes someone to terrify the people, if he was baptized by heretics, or has received their Eucharist and has prayed with them, if he divorced his wife under the pretext of serving God or dedicating himself to a monastic and ascetic life, if he was deposed for good cause and dared resume the function of his former office, if he is one who despised his bishop, left his altar, and made an altar for himself, if he did not answer when called by the bishop, if he left his church for another and afterwards returned to his former church, if he went on a journey or went away to become a monk without the permission of and a letter from the bishop, especially if he went away while excommunicated, if he lets a woman who is menstruating enter the church and give her the Eucharist, or if he gives the nuptial coronation to someone secretly. All this is additional to what is found in the chapter on the clergy in general. Other causes of deposition are found in this chapter in detail, and they consist of two things, the first of which is incora. If at the time of their ordination deacons bind themselves to live without wives, and they marry after their ordination, they shall be deposed from the rank of diaconate. The second is Nicaea, Katag. If a deacon, after being ordained, confesses to a sin he committed before his ordination, he shall be deposed and shall not take part in the service of Mass. If he confesses to it and is reproached publicly in the assembly, he shall be allowed to remain at the rank of subdeacon. Chapter 8. Subdeacons. The anagnostes, or lectors, doorkeepers, singers, and deaconess. This chapter is divided into 5 sections. Section 1. The requirements necessary for appointment. The apostles have said that an anagnosti shall be ordained after being tested. He must not be talkative, a drunkard, or one who cracks jokes. He must be well behaved and devoted to good deeds, one who hastens to attend gatherings at which divine matters are being discussed. He must be obedient, one who reads well, knows in what manner to read, and is diligent to practice what he has read. He must know that a lector must fulfill what he reads, and that it is his duty to fill the ears of the listeners. He must understand the meaning of his text. One who fills the ears of his listeners must know and understand what he reads. If he fails in this, will it not be ascribed to him as a sin before God? Paul, after writing the provisions regarding deacons, said, "Similarly, women shall be chaste and diligent in good works, faithful in all things. They shall not cause disputes. If thou choosest a widow, thou shalt choose one whose age is not less than 60 years, who has been the wife of one husband, and regarding whom people testify that she has done good deeds in her life, one who brought up her children, who has given hospitality to strangers, who washed the feet of saints, who has felt pity for the oppressed, and who has done good deeds. The bishop shall choose saintly women and shall appoint them to serve other women. When women need help, it is not proper that he send a deacon without a deaconess to their houses. Wherefore, deaconesses are appointed for this reason, as well as for the women who is to be baptized. The deaconess anoints the woman's body, after which the deacon anoints her forehead with the sacred oil. It is not proper that a man look at a naked woman, nor shall women be touched by a deacon except for the imposition of hands. Section 2. On their ordination. During the ordination of an anagnosti, the bishop shall first give him the gospel. The bishop shall impose his hands neither on an anagnosti nor on a subdeacon. He shall give them a name so that they may serve the deacon. If the anagnosti has no wife, he shall not be ordained unless it is testified that he keeps away from women. Singers also shall be blessed by the bishop on their ordination. The bishop shall not impose his hands on a virgin, for only her mystery makes her a virgin. Section 3. On their duties. At the beginning, subdeacons are assistants, and anagnostes is a lector. Elapsilides are singers, and anagnosti shall stay at the center of the church on a high place and shall read 2 verses from the books of the Old Testament and from any book of the New Testament. The singer shall sing from the Psalms of David. Doorkeepers shall stay at the entrance reserved for men and shall guard it. Subdeacons shall not serve in the place of deacons, nor shall they touch the vessels of God. Subdeacons shall neither wear the chasuble nor go far from the door, neither at anagnostes, nor singers may wear the chasuble when they read, nor shall doorkeepers go far from the door, even for 1 hour. Doorkeepers must not go far from the door, even for 1 hour. Assistants and doorkeepers shall not handle the chalice of the Eucharist. Deaconesses shall not give benediction, nor shall they perform any of the functions of priests and deacons, but they shall guard the door and serve the priest when the latter baptize women, because this is one of their duties. Deaconesses shall be honored by you, but shall say no word nor do anything without an order from the deacons. No woman shall go to a deacon or to a bishop to ask for anything if she is not accompanied by a deaconess. Deaconess shall teach the other women, shall make them rest when they feel ill, and shall help them. It is not proper that women be priests. They shall not be called by this name, nor shall they intone prayers in the church, nor say prayers to dismiss the faithful, nor pray in a loud voice. Section 4. Causes of disposition not laid down in the preceding chapters and in the chapter on priests. If an anagnosti steals, he shall be driven away from his sin for his sin, and shall be forbidden to read from the reading desk for 1 year. After this, he will be allowed to read again, but he shall not be promoted to the next degree. He shall stay in his degree until his death, because a fault was found in him whilst he occupied the first degree. He must not be trusted in the next degree. If he plays the cittern, he must know and declare that he will not go back to playing it. If he resumes playing it, his punishment shall be 7 weeks of fasting. If he wants to continue playing the cittern, he shall be deposed and driven out of the church. Section 5. Things they may do. An anagnosti or a singer who wants to take a wife after entering church service may do so. If the wife of any anagnosti singer or doorkeeper dies, the anagnosti singer or doorkeeper may take another wife. Chapter 9. On priests and those who follow them. Matters other than those dealt with in detail in the preceding chapters. This chapter is divided in 5 sections. Section 1. On those who are worthy to be priests and what impedes one from becoming a priest. A man who wants to fill our hands with wealth cannot obtain from us what he desires. Whosoever is circumcised after baptism, or made a eunuch by force or by a physician who did this to him because of his illness, may be accepted by the church, provided that he is otherwise worthy to be ordained a priest. Whosoever was made a eunuch by his own will, without any illness, shall not be ordained. Slaves shall not be accepted into any church office without the consent of their masters. This is done to avoid saddening their masters or running the master's house. If a slave is qualified for priesthood, as one Simmons was, and his master frees him, allows him to leave his house, and sets him free publicly in the presence of the people, and if the slave is worthy, he shall be ordained. For a Christian who has confessed his faith and was condemned to chains for Christ's name, the formality of the imposition of hands shall not be required for him to be admitted in the service of the diaconate or priesthood, for he attained the honor of priesthood by confessing his faith with martyrdom. Imposition of hands shall be required if he is promoted to the episcopal rank, but if he is a confessor who was not brought before kings, and was not punished with imprisonment and chains, and suffered no tribulation, but was driven away and despised for his Lord's sake with all his fellow Christians, and was punished in his house and confessed his faith, he is worthy of all clerical positions, but the imposition of hands shall be necessary in this case. No one shall be impeded from ordination by physical defects. As for instance, if he is one-eyed, lame, or left-handed, provided that such individual can say Mass and are worthy, any bishop who dares to prevent them from being ordained shall be suspended from his office until he accepts them. If a layman has the people's testimony that he is worthy to be ordained a priest, he shall not be disqualified by the fact that he does not come from a sacerdotal family, for the church has begot all Christians through the baptism, especially those who observe the law, and the Apostle Paul testifies to this by saying that those who are baptized in Christ are one. Whosoever takes a wife for a second time after baptism, whosoever takes a concubine after marriage, be it openly or secretly, or whosoever has married a widow, two sisters, a woman suspected of adultery, a fornicatress, a slave woman, a woman who is accustomed to going to dancing places, a divorced woman, or a woman who has a bad reputation, he shall not be a bishop, priest, deacon, or one appointed to church office. A member of the faithful who is accused of any act of fornication, luxury, violence, or some similar shameful thing, or one who is reproached publicly, shall not be appointed to any clerical office. One who is troubled by an evil spirit shall not be appointed to any church service, or shall not pray with the faithful. But after he recovers, and is sure that he will not fall ill again, he shall be eligible to hold a clerical office. A neophyte shall not be a priest until he is learned, and until the sanctity of his life, the firmness of his faith, and the purity of his life, which are prerequisites for election, are proved. In connection with this, the Apostle Paul has said, he must not be a new plant, lest he be puffed up with the pride and fall into the judgment of the devil. If a long time passes and a sin on his part is afterwards discovered, which entails a condemnation of the soul, such as weak faith, adherence to doctrine contrary to the faith, or negligence of his duty, he shall not remain in any clerical position. Chrysostom. On saintly fear. The fear of God is a good thing. A man must not be a leader who has no fear of God and is not prudent, for I know of many persons who would deliver themselves into the fetters of monastic life at any time, so much so that they wasted themselves away with fasting and persisted in it, doing nothing to make others grow up before God, and that they preserved in fulfilling only the minor precepts. Yet when they are ordained priests and had to bring others back to the right way, none of them could do it. And some of them who had been ordained priests lost the sanctity they previously gained and were unremediable. A person shall not be admitted to church service simply because he grows old on the middle rank, but he shall be so admitted only if he is deemed worthy. Section 2 on Ordination. We command that a bishop be consecrated by three bishops, or, if there is a scarcity of bishops, by two bishops. But he may not be consecrated by one bishop only, for everything stands and is more clearly manifested by the testimony of two or three. Priests and deacons shall be ordained by one bishop only, as shall be the others who are appointed to church office. But priests and deacons shall not ordain any layman as priest, nor shall they ordain any other person appointed to minor orders. No one shall be ordained without favorable testimony on his behalf. Those who are chosen by the community of the faithful to be clergymen and to be blessed by the bishop shall be brought to him by the archdeacon. The archdeacon shall test them and see if they are vested in the reading of the holy books and in the law of the clerical state. After this, they shall present themselves, and the archdeacon shall test them and have them under his full authority. An archdeacon is the teacher, the one who instructs the people of the city and all the deacons. He is the leader in prayer and is responsible for every duty pertaining to the diaconate. A coruscapiscopus is the superior of the lector at prayer time. The number of priests in the church shall not be few, lest they become few in prayer and in the church services, and lest the see be despised, nor shall they be too many, lest there be a shortage of food for them in the church. Rather, those in charge of the church shall fix their number in such a way that there are enough priests for church service. Section 3 on Ranks. The apostles have said at the beginning of the Didaskalia, we the apostles gathered in Jerusalem have laid down this teaching and have given every rank its appropriate name, modeled on the order of the heavenly spirits. The church, too, must be modeled on the heavenly order, and everyone shall stay at the place to which he is appointed by God. Bishops shall be as shepherds, priests as teachers, deacons as ministers, and subdeacons as assistants. Anagnostes are lectors, Apsilisaion are singers, and the Aphilophlusaion are doorkeepers. The last belong to the class of laymen. The kings who lived in the time of the Old Testament kept their armies but abandoned war. They sought peace in order to save the body, but bishops have received priesthood from God to save the body and the soul from perdition. As the soul is superior to the body, so also priesthood is superior in honor to kingship. It punishes whosoever deserves punishment and forgives whosoever deserves forgiveness. And if he who rises against the king deserves punishment, even he is his son or friend. How much more deserves of punishment is he who opposes priests? And as priesthood is superior to kingship, the punishment of one who opposes the priest is greater than the punishment of one who opposes the king. Neither one shall escape punishment, just as Absalom and Aminadab and Korah and Dathan and Abiram did not escape, because the first two rose against King David, and the others against Moses and Aaron. Every man shall abide in his rank, and no one of you shall attempt to take another's position by violence. If you do so, you will call the wrath of God upon yourselves, as did the sons of Korah, the king and King Uzziah, when they usurped the priestly position against the command of God. The sons of Korah were burnt with fire, and the king's face was covered with leprosy. Moses, to whom God spoke, has fixed the requirements for the ordination of priests. He has stated who, according to these requirements, will be priests, and has duly explained everything. He has set out what is forthcoming to the Levites on account of their rank, and if any man commits a fault by doing something which is beyond his duty, he shall be punished with death. If there were not a law and prescribed distinctions between each degree and every other, every creature would serve with only one name. But when we learned from God the order of the various duties, we set bishops apart in order to make them the teachers of the priests, and we gave priesthood to the priest and to the deacons the duty of serving the priests. And those who exchange ranks do not rise against us, but against the bishop of all creatures, the Son of God, against the teacher of all priests.